Hi for everybody tuning in. We started the E4M event, which is about to discuss things when it comes to marketing technology. I have Siddharth who's joining us. Siddharth is currently the managing director of MIQ India and SAARC. Siddharth was with Google Hi. Previously for about 7 years. He's also a marketing person who's worked with several large CPG brands over the last 15 years. And is currently driving the digital transformation at ITC Foods. Siddharth, I noticed something very interesting that you're a mindful practitioner and you like to understand how these practices change thought patterns and outlook. I think hopefully once this is over, maybe you can give us a few tips because I think mindfulness is something we can all do a little bit with these days, given the interesting times that we're living with.
Definitely. Thanks, Arthur.
Great. Followed by Anushree Ghosh. She's the head of digital strategy and media at ITC Foods. Again, Anushree comes with a lot of experience and, you know, Anushree and Aditi, both of you joined in. It's a good thing to see a lot more women in digital. I think digital was always a fairly sort of limited industry, but I think women have taken a huge leap lately. And I can tell you from personal experience, even at my company, I think it's women who are driving the next wave of digital transformation. So welcome aboard. I mean, it's great to have you over here and I look forward to listening to you. Followed by, we have the second sort of female panelist with us, Aditi. Aditi is the co-founder and head of marketing at Mylene Foundry. Prior to Mylene Foundry, Aditi was a part of the technology and innovation team at Tata Sons, the holding company at Tata Group. Aditi, welcome. Look forward to listening to you.
Thank you. Really excited to be part of this panel. Thank you.
Great. I love the painting in the background.
Thank you. It's not done by me, but it's a nice painting.
So we have Rohit. Rohit is the co-founder and the CEO of Pocket Mobile Ads. Rohit actually is doing a lot of interesting things. It's with Pocket, it's a Singapore-based ad tech company. So Rohit is handling a lot of mobile ads for mobile games in India, SE and MENA. Rohit, your company has been acquired by AnyMind Group from Japan. I mean, that should sort of really put you in a sweet spot, I believe.
Yeah, very sweet spot, especially it got acquired just first week of March when COVID was just beginning and our deal was about to close. So yeah, it was a very...
So basically, it's you and Mukesh Ambani who made the money during the lockdown while the rest of us are still figuring life out.
It's okay.
Right. No, but it's interesting. I mean, you've built a 100 people strong team and, you know, I think before this, you also done some stuff in mobile gaming previously.
Yeah, I was part of creating this brand called Zapak.com with the Reliance Group. So I used to be the CEO of the Reliance's digital businesses and we did a lot of things. A lot of them failed. A couple of them succeeded. Yeah, but been in the digital space now for almost more than 20 years. Yeah.
No, I think, see, the good thing about digital is that failure is a part of the whole journey in that sense. I think we learn more from our failures than successes. But I personally, I've spent a lot of free time on Zapak.com, so I wouldn't exactly call that a failure in that sense. And finally, we have Vaibhav Kumar. He's the Vice President and Head at for E-commerce and Digital Marketing at Max Life Insurance. Vaibhav, again, is a digital evangelist. He's done a lot of stuff over the last 10 years in digital marketing, e-commerce, new product development, incubating new business lines. Vaibhav, something very interesting which I read on your profile is that you've been selected among the Pan India Super 30 CMO Honor and you've been called the 100 smartest digital marketing leaders by the World Marketing Congress. So clearly we are all in August company right now. How does that feel? Like, how did you feel when you were sort of voted as one of the 100 smartest marketing guys?
It felt great. God, nothing beats a 20% drop in ROAS here, honestly.
Great.
Sorry,
yeah. I always find it amazing. I mean, you know, I mean, honestly, for me personally, it's been humbling reading all your profiles in that sense. I mean, some of the stuff you've done, you know, Rohit, Anushree, Aditi, and everybody else, Siddharth, have put in. I think it's amazing, and you know, to know that at least I'm in great company as of today. I don't know about the rest of it, but at least for today, I'm in great company. So thank you all for joining. I think hopefully people who've tuned in will get some valuable insights in terms of what we're about to discuss, and maybe they can walk away with their own learnings. So I'm going to quickly jump onto the first sort of question. And again, I forgive for being on the phone on this event. So feel free if you have any sort of, if you can't hear me properly or anything of that sort. So first question, I mean, which goes out to all of y'all, is that, so marketing technology is the single largest area for investment as of today. What are the key technologies you are focusing on at your end to build a omnichannel offering for your consumers? And what else would you recommend to people, you know, who are tuning in terms of what they should be focusing on when it comes to key technologies? So if you can just start that off with Siddharth and then follow up with everybody else.
Sure. Thanks, Gautam. Thanks for the introductions. And it's great to know about everyone. Really appreciate it. I think from the perspective of technology pieces, I would like to divide into two areas. One is the customer facing technologies, and the other is what you would call on the analytics side and what you have it inside your company where you are making decisions. So on the analytics side, these technologies would include customer identity, intelligence hubs, analytics capabilities, data lake capabilities, so that you don't have silos of your data. And then ultimately it should lead to having a customer data platform, which helps you having a unified view of customers. And on the customer facing side, of course, you have all your organic touch points. And on the ad side, what you need eventually is a programmatic way of doing things where you are able to have a full understanding of consumer journey within all your paid channels. Combining that with organic channels, you will have a very good overall understanding of how the journey is taking place, what factors are affecting the customer decisions. And just to use an example here, because examples always help us understand better. It's very, very important that, you know, clients build this data lake technology as they go along in their journey. And recently we have seen, when we are talking to clients, we have seen a lot of progress in this area, especially during this time as clients are taking a break from hectic marketing campaigns probably, and taking a step back and understanding what they can do with their own data assets. And we are also engaged with clients in this area and helping them build a unified view. So I definitely see a lot of progress happening in this area. And I would say that the most important technology piece would be the unified view of consumer for a brand.
Sheikh, over to you.
So I think I'll just probably borrow a lot of things that Siddharth actually spoke about. Technology actually has been a close ally of marketing for quite some time, but more so now, simply because you will see a lot of leapfrogging that's going to happen when it comes to, you know, digital transformation or integrating technology in the core marketing ecosystem, so to speak. So whether I, you know, talk about consumer focus or consumer facing pieces of technology in the form of advertising or content creation, you know, and we've been using all of these things for quite some time, but in silos or perhaps not to scale. But I guess what's going to happen very quickly is that this is going to be the central part of the conversation from a consumer-facing, you know, a technology that you're going to use in the content creation or advertising ecosystem, so to speak. And then at the back end, I think Siddharth covered a lot of it, and which is, how do you kind of, you know, reach out to consumers and how do you kind of get a sense of or a unified view of their consumer journey, such that you are able to kind of dish out content which is really relevant to them and it kind of pushes them forward in the consumer decision-making journey. So I think all of that content-led commerce, or today, whether there is a video creative that enables you to shop or an Instagram creative that enables you to shop or an Instagram creative that enables you to know more, and stuff like that. So I think that piece is, of course, going to see a whole lot of scale. And I think the pressure is going to be on MarTech creators to kind of come up with new and emerging technologies over and above what already exists today. The other piece actually is for marketers, which is going to be really, really important, is the space of analytics and measurement. So I think media today perhaps has become like a continuum of sorts. So I think marketers don't really or cannot really differentiate between where the piece of content was really served and how did the consumer's mind measure move such that sales kind of got generated, right? So I think from a measurement perspective and evolution in that space, so I think we've seen that researchers have moved or brand tracks have actually moved online. Consumer product trials have actually moved online. Newer consumer experiences have actually moved online. How do I measure the impact of it? Of course, you know, kind of keeping in mind the fact that we are all, operating perhaps in walled gardens. So how do I kind of zoom out and see the consumer journey in unison across the different platforms that the consumer actually uses so that I can effectively plan in a predictive manner, perhaps. And these are all asks from the marketer in me, perhaps, you know, to kind of come up with technology solutions which kind of address these spaces. So if you ask me what has been used to scale today, I think a lot of consumer facing, MarTech solutions are being used to scale today, which is, you know, from an advertising and content creation perspective. There are various possibilities in that space that exist. There is a lot of artificial intelligence based deployment that is going to happen and that is happening. But again, a lot more possibilities that exist and technology can play a very, very strong role there. And of course, the third piece essentially is going to be measurement. And how do we really become sophisticated when it comes to cross-channel, measurement wherever the consumer is, such that one is able to kind of understand the impact on brands and then make data-driven decisions, so to speak. So I think that's pretty much the space that I'm in.
See, it's very interesting. I think both Siddharth and you kind of spoke about it. We are definitely seeing a shift in terms of conversations from digital heads. You know, it used to start with saying "isko train karwa do," and now it's moved into sort of the analytics space. I think the one interesting point that you did mention was content-led commerce. I think that is one key area which is going to boom to a significant degree. Yeah.
Related to the growth of e-commerce as well. I mean, this lockdown, I think e-commerce companies have seen an inflection point, just like how, you know, mobile wallets saw it during demonetization. Perhaps e-commerce companies actually saw their scale and inflection point during this time. So I think content-led commerce is going to be a very large conversation for a lot of marketers like me.
Yeah, that's very interesting. Aditi, anything to build upon that, your point of view?
Yes, Gautam, I think great points by both Siddharth and Anushree. Just wanted to add like a layer on top of that and kind of reaffirm that we are talking about, for example, consumer-led commerce. We're talking about understanding the customer journey, right? And when we look at the customer journey, the kind of data that traditionally is available to organizations, not just from a marketing perspective, but overall, has traditionally been very structured data, right? Data that you can put into an Excel sheet and actually create analytics around it. But now with content, you know, with the content explosion happening, 6 out of 10 people today sort of watch online video over television, right? So content has just exploded. How can you actually start building the intelligence around not just structured data, but also unstructured data? So video data, voice data, and even in case of industrial use cases, sensor data, right? I think that is a layer which is going to grow really, really fast. And I think it's, we all have to join that bandwagon and think about data beyond, the way we look at data today and think of video, voice, and sensor data as well. So I just wanted to add that piece to what Anushree and Siddharth are saying.
Interesting. Rohit?
Yeah, sure. I think MarTech as a category, as an industry, is very vast. You know, it has, the MarTech stack has so many pieces, from analytics to CRM to advertising to data to social media and so on and so forth. But I think for us, there are two key parts of the MarTech piece where we are seeing huge disruption and very positive changes. One is when we look at the advertising technologies. I think the whole programmatic piece has totally changed the rule of the game. The way marketers were looking at audiences, at publishers, networks, partners, and the way today content owners are looking at audiences. So I think one, programmatic is making the whole piece extremely measurable, extremely ROI driven, And today we have global matrices like, you know, from viewability to in target to brand safety, so many things which are changing the rule of the game. I think the second big thing again, which is relevant to us and a part of MarTech, is the data platforms. I think the whole DMP piece, which is being integrated in all programmatic buying and the way DSPs are integrating it, is again for marketers creating so much relevancy in terms of how everything on a DMP platform you can manage, from your frequency capping to personas to users to whatever you want to do. So I think, yeah, for in our experience in the last few years, these two pieces have really disrupted it's all tech driven, obviously, have disrupted the ecosystem and is making more challenging and more opportunistic for the marketing.
Interesting. Vaibhav, anything in terms of closure on this question that you would like to add?
Sure, Gautam. I think it's pretty much covered. But really, if I, look at it as an advertiser and zoom out, you know, the utopic state for an advertiser hasn't changed really, I think, in the last 200 years. It's been about right person into right time, into right channel, into right communication, right? That's been the constant equation for any advertiser for the last 200 years, I believe, right? But I think how the things have evolved, I think what I experience as an advertiser today when I deal with some of the agencies, or you know, when I'm out there deploying a smart display campaign or a programmatic campaign, what I realize is that the one view of customer has never been more important than now. I think that one unified view is extremely, extremely important. It's actually, it'll soon become a hygiene, I feel. And I think, honestly, thanks to the walled gardens, as you know, Aditi said, we have, on some of these media platforms like Facebook and Google, MarTech itself, it's going to need, instead of a luxury. I mean, for any advertiser who's to optimize for ROAS, and with these walled gardens, the way we operate, it's really a need. And I think, has it taken off? I think it already has taken off, at least in Indian digital market, I see. I mean, I don't know of anyone who's right now possibly not using, for someone who just starts off their business, maybe a double click panel on search will be a big help. But what I realize is that beyond the tools, I think what is the most critical part is how the marketing fraternity now needs to learn engineering. I think that is a very, very important trend. Actually, without it, it doesn't matter. Honestly, it doesn't matter. You can be the best marketer in the world, but if you don't have a couple of good engineers within the marketing fraternity, within your scope, I think it really, it falls flat, is what I've experienced in the past.
So that's a very interesting point. And I think I'm just going to do a follow-up on this question to all of y'all in that sense, because, Vaibhav mentioned the fact that you need more engineers from a marketing perspective. Do you think that our over-reliance on marketing technology is going to kill the creative, or it's going to kill our ability to tell stories like we used to with advertising back in the day? Or do you think it will become as clinical using, technology and platforms? I mean, what are your thoughts, all of y'all, on this front?
Can I go first, Gautam?
Sure, of course.
So I actually don't think it is going to be that way, because I think all of the tools that we are using is only going to be enabling, right? I mean, just take a simple example. Even something like a Photoshop or a Canva is a tool, but it's only helping with creativity, right? So yeah. I think that overall, MarTech should be considered as an enabler. It shouldn't be considered as something which is going to replace. Because at the end of the day, and like Vaibhav mentioned, it's all about making that connect, right? It's about who are you selling to, what are you trying to sell, and that aspect of it won't go away. A tool cannot, of course, a tool can help better decision making, maybe understanding the customer better, but at the end of the day, there is still a creativity element which is very quintessential to marketing, to branding, to advertising, which according to me won't go away. But would love to hear the thoughts of others.
So I would like to add here, actually, and I think it's a very important question, especially for CPG brands, where brand storytelling is at the heart of communication, right? And there is very little way to kind of assess the action that the consumer takes, because CPG purchases, still, I think e-commerce at the most contributes to say around 4 to 5% of the overall sales Right. So it's still a very offline, communication to sales. There is a lag that happens. So brand storytelling is really, really at the heart of communication for CPG brands. Right. But I think what becomes really crucial is to assign the role to each of these platforms. So, for example, if it's video platforms, a person there is essentially to be creative within the guardrails of that platform and stay true to the consumer behavior that the consumer actually exhibits on that platform. There is no point being creative and yet you kind of really demean the fact that there is no opportunity to see that you are creating for the consumer. So I think it's crucial to kind of assign the role to each of the platforms that you're using and then kind of, that clinical layer, the clinical layer that you spoke about, it's very crucial to generate that opportunity to see and hence mental availability for the brands that you want to really, really kind of drive sales for, right, at the end of the day. So I think that's where it's kind of a marriage of, art and science, as they say. The science here is becoming a lot more overpowering, but the scope of creativity is kind of shifting. It's not in that 30-second or a 45-second TVC that erstwhile creative people used to win Cannes Lions for. It's going to be the 10-second or the 7-second creative story that you're able to tell. And that's where the true test of creativity actually comes in.
Anybody else who wants to add to this?
Yeah, I would just like to, add from our experience. I think historically, it has been that, creativity is the ownership of television and TVCs, as Anushi was saying, or 30-40 second TV commercials and digital is all about measurements and ROI and everything. But I think if you look at it in the last 5 years, the amount of innovation that has happened on mobile advertising, even outside of video in rich media, for example, today, on an average, we do more than 40 to 50 innovations with over, so many brands across markets. And actually, it has become seamless. And, 4 years ago, we could never thought that we could run very complex creatives, rich media creatives through programmatic and measure them and measure engagement. It's now all happening. So I think this is the time when, brand story, brand building and creativity can happen on digital, and measure too.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I would just add just what Rohit said was that. Yeah, sorry, Anushi, go ahead.
So just one more point. I think in the mind of the marketer or the mind of a regular creative agency, creative guy, essentially, if the objective is awareness, the outcome is going to be a 30-second video. So that is actually shifting. And like Rohit, I think, pointed out, what's going to happen is even if the objective is awareness or equity building, it can very well be brought alive through experiences which are immersive and on device which you are carrying on a regular basis in your hand. So yeah, I think there is a shift there actually.
Yeah, I agree completely, Anushi. And just to add to what Rohit said, I think technology is also enabling understanding consumer cohorts in a better way. And then having personalization strategies. And with these two, then it is kind of also giving you a lot of time to figure out, okay, these are my cohorts. This is how I can personalize and then add a very strong creativity layer on top of it and kind of have a very strong, like an optimization way of doing creative campaigns as well, right? Because and again, as Anushi was saying, things are changing and from a 30 seconder, we are moving into 10 seconder or even lesser kind of thing. But then did that 30 seconder apply to all the cohorts? I think that was also a question, right? And that's where, a better understanding of cohorts and then applying creativity is, I think, a better way of doing it.
So in a way, the ROI to the creativity is, you can get it faster now, maybe, or you can see the results faster than you could before and more accurately probably.
No, it's interesting that the word ROI is being mentioned with creativity in the same sentence now.
As you know, we jokingly say with our agency conference, nothing beats 100 bips improvement in CTR. Nothing. Funnel, right?
True.
Absolutely correct.
I've been the victim of that, so I can vouch for it. No, but interestingly, the common theme that I'm getting from all your answers is about the connect with the consumer in that sense, which brings me to my next question, wherein the core idea of MarTech is to help improve and integrate customer experience across advertising, analytics, engagement, and so on and so forth. Are these investments helping at your end, and how do you measure this at your end?
So I could address that if that's okay. At least my limited experience through a real use case. See, my advice to my team, which is my experience, Gautam, so far has been to be extremely wary of the shiny object syndrome, as we call, right? SOS. Be extremely wary of it, because what happens usually is some of these technologies look really cool, but they might not be of much use to you, actually, honestly, because it has to start with a problem, right? It has to start with a business case, a use, either an opportunity or a problem statement. And then as you try and discover the solution, the MarTech tool will actually be the enabling tool for it. Because the risk I see, at least what I've experienced, is that sometimes you get carried away as an advertiser and along with an agency to say, this tool could possibly change the way I look at my metrics and significantly, you know, boost my ROAS. And then you go in that direction without realizing. And that's what exactly happened with us about 6 months back as an advertiser, when we went ahead with a couple of tools without realizing that, you know, the problem we had was entirely different, and we actually needed, what we needed honestly was something completely different than what we actually deployed. So honestly, is it helping? Absolutely, yes. I think it helps you make disciplined experiments. That's most important. I think the cost of experiments has come down significantly thanks to these tools. From a long-term perspective, I think I continue to believe that the most powerful tool actually is GTM, the Google Tag Manager, honestly. I mean, there's nothing that it can't do. I mean, if you have the right set of engineers with you. So is it helping? Absolutely. I think it if you have the right skill, if they have the skill inside within capability within your engine, I think it's definitely helps a lot. And the metrics, I think the lifetime value of the customer or the cross sells lines, at least there I've seen, personally seen in the last 12 months, significant uplift in terms of the way we cross sell product categories or the lifetime value we are able to generate through a consumer thanks to the personalization available. On acquisition, I think we can measure, but I'm yet to arrive. I mean, honestly, personally, I'm yet to arrive at a hypothesis where I've been able to improve my acquisition metrics through some of these tools. But am I able to measure better? Yes, absolutely.
Interesting. I'm going to circle back to Siddharth. Siddharth, we'll start off with you in terms of, answering the following up on what Vaibhav had to say.
Yeah. No, I completely agree with Vaibhav. And I, in my experience, whenever clients have taken a basic principles approach, like what is the problem and what am I trying to solve? And then who is my consumer with whom I'm going to solve this problem? I think that is where it starts, and that is where then the technology really helps. And this is one of our favorite case study. I just want to talk about that, is that this is a big credit card brand where they wanted to understand that, we are doing marketing campaign for our credit card, and they are applying, consumers are applying, and then there is a rejection rate, right? So out of 10 applicants, 4 are getting rejected. So how can we reduce this rejection rate? So what we did was we helped them understand their consumers, and we did a first party data analysis, and then a classic programmatic approach also applied third party audiences to have a better understanding of their consumer profiles, their consumer portraits. And then we also integrated their CRM data. And that's where, that this MarTech discussion really comes into relevance, because you need to have capability to integrate data from other sources and then make sense of your consumer portraits. And then from there, we were able to understand that, okay, these are the consumers with these kind of behaviors who are trustworthy, and these are not getting rejected. And then that is how the marketing campaign was tweaked towards those consumer portraits, and the brand got a improvement in efficiency by 65%. So I would say that investment in tools, again, as Weber said, is not what the approach should be. Approach should be, what is the problem I'm trying to solve? And then to solve that problem, how should I look at my data? What are the other data sources which I can kind of look at? And then figure out how to, go about solving the problem. And then you can reap a huge amount of benefit. If you end up going into a tools journey, then that's a never-ending journey. And that's not the right way to go about it.
Right. You know, Vaibhav mentioned GTM in that sense. Anything personally that you use, which sort of has helped you the most in terms of MarTech?
In terms of MarTech, yeah, I would say that how do you get consumer portraits? You get consumer portraits by doing first-party data analysis, which is where you use GTM to understand the first-party data, right? So I completely agree on that part as well. GTM is one of the most important tools. Then the other part is what are the programmatic solutions which you are using, because then that will help you to, again, in a DSP environment, you can analyze the first-party data, augment third-party data, also integrate CRM data, and then do the targeting in the right way. So all these are available from a DSP technology perspective. So yeah, any DSP technology which you are familiar with, which you have competence on, or which you know your agency has a competence on, and your ability to, again, integrate data sources and then solve the problem, that is how it will happen.
Interesting. Thank you. Anushree?
I think
she's here. I got disconnected for a little bit. Just to kind of come back to the question on attribution and measurement, and I think how marketing technology can actually play a role here. And I'm talking predominantly as a CPG brand owner. You know, nothing will take away, and I think we are a long way from the you know time when brand track is not going to be crucial, or you know there is going to be an alternate way of you know, measuring the impact of communication on mind measures or sales, so to speak. I think marketing technology actually has been playing and needs to play a much larger role when it comes to measurement of impact of campaigns, which is not really reflective in the path to purchase on digital alone. So I think, and this is going to be the sentiment that you will hear from anyone where the substantial part of the sales is still coming offline, or it is still not, you know, directly attributable to the consumer journey that is exhibited on digital. So I think, you know, single source planning, single source measurement across different, you know, across the consumer journeys, across different mediums, I think that's going to become the key, and technology is and will be playing a very important role there. And I think we've seen how the one source, you know, planning tool, as well as the one source measurement tool, which is Bark and Nielsen, kind of integrating the ACOM conversation, which has kind of gone, you know, into an infinite loop. But I think solutions like that is going to become very, very important, because the consumer, in the mind of the consumer, mediums don't really exist. They don't really go to television to view an ad. They actually go to the television or to their digital whatever device that they are consuming content on to view content. So I think that's measurement is going to be a very, very important space where MarTech is going to continue to play you know, a very substantial role.
Interesting. Aditi?
I just wanted to bring in one more perspective. I really, really like all the views that are coming in. I was just thinking when Anushree was talking, and you know, Siddharth as well. So I have two kinds of experiences. One end of the spectrum is a new startup where everything is starting from scratch, right? In which case, I'm using this tool, right? Hence, enterprise B2B customers. So let's say we started off by saying, am I audible? Hello? My connection says a little unstable.
Yeah, we couldn't hear you you just dropped off for a second over there. So if you can just start.
Okay, am I audible now?
Yeah.
Right. So what I was saying is right now, as a co-founder of a young startup, all the decisions on what tools, what measurement is straight determined by what is the need of the hour, right? So right now I need X. So I'm going to get the bare minimum. So we also do not want to overcomplicate things in a very, very young sort of fledgling startup. The other end of the spectrum is, you know, my time at Tata Group. So when I was basically part of the holding company of the group, and you know, we were working on a project where we were looking across all consumer-facing data companies and thinking through how can we unify all of this, right? How can we have a 360-degree view of the customer? In which case, often you have to go retrospective. You have to look at, okay, this is the kind of data we have. This is the kind of touch points we have. What kind of tools would really help to give a better view of the customer. So while, you know, absolutely, I do think that tools cannot sort of precede intent. It always has to be an intent that leads to what tool is needed. But it also kind of depends on the stage of the company you are in, sort of, you know, where you're coming from, what is the output you are asking for at that point of time. So just wanted to mention that as well.
Absolutely. And that's true even for the life stage of the brand. Like if you're a new or a young brand, I mean, I think the measurement requirements are very different.
Yes, absolutely.
Interesting. Lastly, Rohit, anything to add on this front?
Yeah, you know, whereas, you know, Vaibhav and you know, Anushree are marketers and, you know, they are saying that, you know, the marketer should be very clear what do they want to use, which tools and all. But I think it's easier said than done. It's not very easy to practice. We work with more than 100 marketers from Unilever to P&G to even ITC to everyone. I think the marketers are bombarded and overwhelmed with so many tools in the market. It's challenging for them to even choose and say it keeps on changing, right? For example, we, in our business, when we run video ads, there is a way to measure the viewability. I think in the last 3 years, more than 20 tools have come which say that, you know, we are a better tool to measure viewability. It could be, you know, so many. So I think it's such a, so as publishers and content owners, we also get frustrated with marketers, but we feel more sorry for them because it is such a challenging task. There are 100 things to measure and each thing has 100 tools to measure them for. So I think it's a big bloody problem. And it's easier said than done that, you know, we should know what tool we want, but I think it's tough. It's not easy. It's a big challenge.
So interestingly, you know, there was a point made a couple of minutes back about single source planning. Do you think it'll be possible to have, and this is a really bad analogy that I'm giving you, that given the number of tools that we have, it's almost become like Andheri Link Road. Do you think we can probably build some sort of a highway that will help sort of, you know, things smoothen out the process, that if we can have one single dashboard that helps marketers, agencies, consumers to be able to do this all, do you think that's a pipe dream or you think it's possible? Something that simplifies this entire sort of approach to, instead of having 20 tools and, you know, web of experimenting and so on and so forth. Do you think that's possible at your end? Have you seen any progress at all in that front?
Yeah, can I start on this? So
sure,
I would say that it is possible. Is it 100% possible? You know, like the complete ideal environment? No, because things are always changing. And see, the other part is that tools, all the tools in the market have their own agendas, right? Because they are, you know, working with their technology, and in technology game, always it is a question of, you know, which technology becomes a standard, and it's a right thing to do for them, right? I've been in many technology companies, and it's right thing to do very much for them. So given in this environment, I think what is possible is that, yes, there are walled gardens, there are, you know, open systems, there are a mix of tools, all those things are there. But at the end of the day, it is very important for a client to create a data lake where you have all the data coming in from various sources. And also the ability that in future, when I'm doing marketing campaigns, I'm able to use my second party data and also augment that with third party data so that I keep adding to my data lake and try to, you know, keep enhancing my CDP, right? Ultimately, you know, that is the goal which you would want to have. And that, I would say, it applies to all the companies at all stages, right? We are using CDP, and CDP generally means that, you know, it's, we are talking about the data set and big company and all those things, but it's not necessary that that is what we are looking for a startup, for example. But the point is that we go with this intent, we go with this planning, and then there are, and then you judiciously evaluate tools and then add in your system so that you have this capability over a period of time, so that you are adding to your data system as you go along, and with your every marketing campaign and every touch point, you have the capacity to have that data in your system and then ability to do the analysis on that. It is possible, and we have done it for many clients.
Interesting. Anybody would like to add anything on top of what Siddharth had to say?
So I think I completely agree with this point. And, you know, while 1 year ago or 2 years ago, I think marketers were not really looking or even harnessing the power of their first party data I'm talking predominantly about organizations which are looking at a lot of top funnel communication, right? So first party data importance has always been there as a digital marketer. I think that's probably one of the cardinal principles of digital planning, so to speak. But I think, you know, enhancing or creating or nurturing a base of first party data and each campaign that you run, which enriches the data that you are kind of, you know, capturing as you kind of go, perhaps is probably one of the key strategies that brands are adopting. And I think it's gradually becoming hygiene for all brand owners. So I think that's a piece that is going to be probably the way digital planning happens today, rather than, you know, working with multiple publishers and arriving at, you know, if you don't have your own set of audiences which are effective and probably efficient in the past, I think that nurturing will become a hygiene for digital planning going forward.
Yeah, and I think in our experience, the CPG companies have especially really, you know, led the
forward.
Today, if you look at the way Unilever, P&G and all these companies are so efficiently managing data, building personas, actually they have become walled gardens of their own now in that sense. But I think the way they have managed and leveraged the DMPs, the CDPs and the whole programmatic piece is just amazing. And I think a lot of companies should learn from them and you know, follow them in the way they've managed that, I think.
Interesting. I'm going to go on to my next question. And this is more from, you know, it's a little bit personal in that sense. How have you used marketing technology to enhance your own marketing abilities in that sense? I mean, how has that helped you as professionals in your field? And more so, this is in context to establishing a connect with your audiences. The idea is that, you know, because as professionals, you come across a whole bunch of technology platforms and products and tools in that sense. Is there anything specifically that you've used that has helped you tackle your day-to-day and helped you sort of connect with your audiences? So we'll start off with Siddharth and then end at Vaibhav.
I would say so I've been more on the sales side rather than on the marketing side of the things. So I would, you know, I would have to talk about from a broader trends I've seen with hundreds of clients I've worked with in my past journeys. I would say that it depends on various verticals, vertical by vertical also tools can differ. But if I just take as an example of say e-commerce, as a vertical, right? So from an e-commerce perspective, I think the most important tools which they have used, I've seen, is the how do you manage your website, the content management system, and your tag management system, right? And also how you are looking at from an app perspective, your app measurement system. These are the fundamental systems by which you understand how consumers are interacting with you. And the reason why I took e-commerce vertical is because all the touch point is digital, and that's where, you know, you are getting maximum amount of consumer behavior then and there itself, right? So with these set of tools, you are able to have a very, very good understanding of your consumers. And then basis that you can do in organic actions as well as paid actions and keep working on your marketing objectives. And also from there, it is easier for you to then build a data system and the analytics capabilities, which will help you to kind of go into that ideal stage which we are talking about, where we are, you know, talking about various consumer cohorts and how do you do personalization and take more actions around that as well.
Anushi?
Yeah. So I think on a regular, you know, as a part of an ongoing, you know, way of working with MarTech, I think MarTech is very integral. And I think Rohit just, you know, spoke about how CPG brands are using it, and it's not really new to any of the brands today. So I think mass personalization with, you know, data-driven insights. So I think using your own data, so, and, you know, perhaps creating creative solutions which are tailor-made to the segment that you're actually reaching out to you know, nurturing the data and retargeting and all of that. So I think it's the entire funnel, full funnel planning, which is kind of adopted through a very robust data strategy. I think that's something that is used on a regular basis. It's becoming like a hygiene. So I think in enhancing your data management platform as you go, and how do you kind of harness the potential of mass personalization through creatives, I think that's something that is used on a regular basis. But from a measurement also, I think there are many solutions which are being used today. So whether it's, you know, arriving at a digital panel to do a digital track of sorts, I think Nielsen today has a decent panel that one could actually mount a study on, and which is very digitally administered, and then you know, you can understand the impact of what you did you know, over a period of time in a rolling basis. I think those are all things that are very technology based and are being used by brands consistently, and so is the case with CPG brands. So I think that's something that is being used very, very consistently by us.
Anything that you use personally at your end which has helped you?
The virtual meeting, whether it's Microsoft Teams or so, you know, that's changed life.
Fair enough.
Proximal.
I'll give you Zoom. I think fair enough. I think Zoom is a great tool in that sense.
And of course, e-commerce. I think somebody had told me that you live in an app, you know, ecosystem. Your life is straddling from one app to another, whether it's, you know, personal care, whether it's calling for a service or a handyman, to ordering for even food. So I think even in these times, I think that's become like a norm to kind of probably fall back on. So I think that's what it has been.
Aditi, anything at your end?
Absolutely. I want to give the view of, you know, for a very small startup to be actually selling to enterprise B2B. Interestingly, a very, very simple tool that, you know, all of us are using, which really, really helps, is LinkedIn. The reason for that is, you know, when you're trying to sell to a large organization, you're actually not selling to the organization. You're selling to, individuals within the organization, right? Their personalities within the organization. You need to understand those personalities, understand those individuals, and actually make those connections. So I think one tool that I absolutely think has helped us, which is a very simplified tool, is LinkedIn. Not just from a lead generation perspective, but just from insights, understanding, and kind of figuring out what is the right way to position, what is the right way to target, right? The second piece that I want to mention, which is not exactly, it may not be called a MarTech tool, but it really helps in the early stages of a go-to-market for a company, is to actually have a tool which includes the strategy, product, and sort of marketing all in one. So we, for example, use a tool called AHA, which is quite popular amongst a lot of tech startups, where it unifies the view, of who you are as a company, what is your product strategy, and how does your marketing strategy sort of align to that. So I think quite simplified tools really helps in sort of figuring out where exactly is your product market fit, what is the direction you need to go into. Are you really in the right direction, or you need to pivot, right? So I think those are two tools that we use quite a lot. Simple tools, but very helpful in the early stages of a company.
Interesting. Rohit, moving on to you.
I think from a business side, I'll give you guys some data points. So our platform today gets almost 600 million monthly unique active users and device IDs. In India alone, we have about 220 million monthly unique users coming to our platform playing games. So I think for us in the last 2 to 3 years, we have spent huge amount of resources, investments behind data platforms. I think there is no DMP or data company globally or India, we have not worked with or invested in to ensure that we make our data. So now we have our own DMP, but I think eventually we still work for us companies like Lotame, Mobile Wala, Persona Graph. Some of them have worked very well in certain scenarios. And we have really used these data tools to, and today our data, because of that reason, has become so rich, and the profiling of data that we have, so that we are very, very easily able to deliver some interesting personas and audiences to our marketers and advertisers.
Vaibhav, last word.
So really, Gautam, the way we've used it professionally is really, I can explain it into three separate small parts really, is advertising, onboarding, and nurturing. If I was to divide the entire journey into three separate unique parts, you know, on the advertising front, surely I think just like all advertisers, we use some of the tools. I mean, it's obvious, right? The big media conglomerates like Facebook and Google, right? They love collation of data. They do not want segmentation. They will always push you for discovery platform. Leave it to us. We are the machine learning engine, right? That's what they will tell you as the advertiser. But the outcome becomes that you end up experiencing outcomes, right? Instead of controlling it. And then you are questioned in various forums and you say, how do I control this here? I mean, it's like a Google algorithm controlling everything. So you end up trying to segment, you know, instead of collation, the advertiser wants to actually micro-segment it instead of collating it. So I think some of the platforms on that front have been pretty, pretty helpful, honestly, for us on the advertising side. On the onboarding side, I'm a big fan of Optimize and GTM. Yeah, I think what it enables marketers is that, you know, suddenly I don't need to wait for engineering bandwidth or the technology teams to up their game. Guess what? 33% of the changes that I want to do in my journey, I actually get it done in one day, and then the engineering team is chasing us. Isko engineering karna hai, bhai, ye toh bhi experiment kiya hai. So I don't need to rely on the engineering or the releases, as we call it, for doing most of the ABs now. So I think that's been a big advantage for me, at least. I mean, you need to have the right set of people for it. That's what I realized a year back. So we invested heavily on that front. But guess what? Now I don't rely too much on tech team working on releases for me to do an A-B test, which is a big advantage, I think. And the last part, I think, in terms of nurturing, I think that's a given. The whole SMS, email, notification, that entire, and WhatsApp for business, right? All that has to be an integrated MarTech tool, right? You can't do without it. I won't name the partner, but really it's Netco that we use, for example, in this case. But I think without a single unified tool, there is no way that you can, you know, optimize for the number of times you want a user to come back again. So I think on the three specific parts, that's how we've been using it, honestly.
Interesting. Just for the ones who've just tuned in, there's a lot of questions that have been coming in. So we will address all those questions once our Q&A session is over. We will give all the panelists a chance to answer any questions that have been coming in. I'm going to quickly jump onto the fourth and the second last question of the day. Have you personally, all of you all, come across any global marketing or tech trends that you think brands and organizations are adopting in India? Anything that you've seen globally which is being used over here across your personal organizations that you're working at, or anything that you might have noticed?
So I can start with this. I think there are two things which are very critical, and those are the trends which are really shaping the market now. So one is, as we discussed that, you know, understanding your first party data and then augment that with second and third party data. And even within that, I think it is very critical, and that's what we have achieved, is that you have different data sources, and you know, you can obviously combine in a DMP different third party data sources. And then how do you make it like one-to-one do the mapping so that the richness of the data keeps increasing, and that's where then the match rates with the first party data go up, and that's how clients are able to take full advantage of their own data. That is one. And then the second big trend which we are seeing is, how do you take macro trends also which are impacting your consumer's behavior and how consumers are interacting with your brand. So I'll just give a quick example. So we were working with a financial client, and then they wanted to market an investment product. So what we did was, our data science team did a correlation with demand of their product with the dollar exchange rate with multiple currencies. And this analysis helped us to understand that there are these trends where if dollar is going strong against these particular currencies, then that is the best time to intensify on the marketing campaign. that is where the demand of the investment solution increases. And that, by integrating that macro trend, we were able to help the brand get very strong ROI. And that is something which also would be a critical piece and a trend which will come into play in the in future, in the coming years.
Interesting. Anushree, anything at your end that you're seeing in terms of trends?
So a macro trend which has really impacted or opened up a couple of business opportunities for us has been, you know, following the heat map of infections and containment zones, very, very relevant to this time. So the more the containment zone happens, the lesser is the access of a whole lot of e-commerce organizations to kind of reach the consumer. So, or, you know, the serviceability becomes lower and lower. So I think a lot of CPG brands, and I think ITC was one of the first ones to kind of launch it, was a war room like setup where you kind of track the containment zones and plan, you know, Store on Wheels was an initiative which was launched, which was essentially bringing, so we have a D2C destination, it's called ITC Store. We try to make like a physical, you know, manifestation of the same. And I think it was really well, you know, kind of being in real time tracked and mapped to, you know, the infection containment zone, so to speak. So I think that opened up a very large business opportunity for us. And I think it's not a macro. I mean, I think it could be a macro trend, but yeah, it kind of was real-time reaction to kind of spotting a business opportunity based on what's happening currently.
No, it's really interesting that you say that. And of course, you know, as an individual and as an organization, we've been doing our fair share of sort of pivoting in COVID times. And I can tell you, and this is an interesting statistic that was pointed out to me by somebody, that 86% of sort of helping consumers across Mumbai as a city has come in through brands and organizations in that sense. I think the gap that has been sort of very evident because of the lack of policy, and of course, it is not our job to criticize any government in that sense, but there has been a policy gap in that sense. And we are seeing more and more brands and organizations stepping in and ensuring that, you know, consumers are really handheld and taken care of in these times. So I think that's one thing in our favors as organizations and brands and agencies.
Absolutely.
That, you know, we've really stepped up to help sort of containment zones in this time of crisis. So Aditi, moving on to you, anything that you've noticed from a global perspective that you're adopting in India?
So Gautam, I think this the one trend I'm going to talk about is a trend which is very much in India and might be globalizing from India. And I think that trend is that of vernacularization. And as an AI company, we do get suddenly a lot of, brands, organizations are turning to vernacular. The need for vernacular always existed, right? I mean, India always had a need for vernacular, but the, you know, the ability to do vernacular is way more possible now than before, whether it is in speech, you know, just overall content. So I do think that that's an amazing trend, which is seen in India, also globally, but a great trend that I think will really revolutionize the way even marketing is done, right? I mean, we have to start looking at the vernacular requirements of the country. And I think that's a macro trend I just wanted to mention is very exciting.
Interesting. Rohit?
In our industry, Gautam, fortunately or unfortunately, every single global tool or every single global trend comes the next day. You know, so because it is all driven by large global companies. So if you look at measurability, then all the measurability trends and tools are global. If you look at in target, if you look at data, so I think, which is a good part because the learning curve also kind of reduces. But in our case, we see, especially in mobile, video, digital advertising, all global trends are adopted and embraced immediately, whatever is happening in the Western markets or Israel or Japan or whatever, wherever the tool or the trend is is having a successful stuff.
Interesting. Vaibhav, over to you. Last word in.
So Gautam, I think for the within the Indian context, I think e-commerce and travel had a significant advantage, right? They were born digital, as we call these categories, right? So in a way, they have had a heads up in terms of the tools being leveraged, or you know, almost creating trends. But within the BFSI context, you know, and when I talk to my friends and peers, some of these traditional banks, traditional insurers, the way we've picked up digitization, I think it's interesting that I hear this never ask again principle, you know, being pretty taken up pretty seriously within the BFSI context, you know, where we try to personalize. I mean, we followed that as a principle for last 18 months now. But when I talk to some of my friends in banks and all, suddenly there's a heightened awareness in terms of when a consumer is engaging with the servicing app or is, you know, trying to buy something out, the personalization has become pretty important, which I like actually, which is a very, very refreshing change for a category or a domain, you know, which has been as old as, I don't know how many years, right? Banking and financial services. So I think that's one thing that's picked up well. I see a lot of CMOs now talking about it and taking it seriously. The other one I see, which I'm very happy about, is really on data security. I see a large amount of investment happening and, you know, being very careful about what to personalize and what not to personalize. I think I see a lot of conversations happening there, which is very, very heartening. I know a couple of years back when we actually personalized a campaign for diabetic people, because we knew those guys are diabetic, right? As part of insurance. And we actually got rogered. We got rogered by the customer on social media that, guess what? You're showing me ads that, you know, you have a plan for diabetics. How do you even know I'm diabetic? So I see a lot of sensitivity on that front. So I think those are two sides. I see some really good progress happening in the BFSI category.
Interesting. Vaibhav, there was a point made which was on vernacular and sort of, you know, the multilingual approach in that sense as well. Anything that you personally sort of utilized at your end?
So, on these two fronts? Yeah, sure. So I think vernacular for us right now is more about organic wins at an organization level. We're trying to create more organic wins on vernacular. Is it critical? I think I completely agree. I think it's been the part of the great three V's that you know, most of the all digital strategists keep telling us, you know, vernacular, voice and video, that always has been critical for all digital advertisers in the current context. But I think I still don't see the amount of effort that it deserves is being invested. I think we still, at least in the BFSI context, except for the PSU banks, I think where vernacular is not a choice, right? It's not an option. But for private banks and private life insurers, I still see vernacular as a more as a hobby than as a must do right now in terms of the, but I see good work on the organic side. I don't think anyone is willing to put their money up there. But on the organic front, I think everyone wants good traffic, right?
Interesting. I'm going to move on to the last and final question from my end. And this is, again, you know, it's something extremely relevant. What do you think will be the customer experience roadmap for brands and organizations that, you know, you are affiliated to or that you come across post COVID-19? And I just want to add a little bit to it. I think a lot of us, you know, governments across the world and a lot of CEOs have been talking about something called as the new normal in that sense. At one point, the expectation is that people have to live with, you know, adjust and live with COVID-19. The other expectation that has been set is that there is a hope of a vaccine that will come in. So what do you think, will be the expectations from consumers post sort of COVID-19? And we'll again, as usual, start off with Siddharth and then move on to Vaibhav.
Thanks, Gautam. You're asking us to predict future, which we all want to get to post-COVID. So I think two things. One is there is definitely, what we're seeing is, and what we are also doing as an organization is that, so as an organization, we specialize in, you know, integrating data from various sources and then providing that value in the programmatic environment. And globally and in India also, what we are seeing the trend is that post-COVID, there will be two screens. One is the small screen, which is mobile. And the second screen is the big screen, which is the TV. And both these screens are increasingly, of course, mobile already. So there will be huge shift and also So overall, what I'm trying to say is that there will be two key channels which marketers will have to look at, which is these two. And what we are adding on to capabilities is that how do we help marketers understand the consumer behavior between these two, digital and TV, and help them optimize. Because increasingly boards will be asking that earlier you used to do like a 2,000, 3,000 GRP plans. But now there is so much of shift which has happened from TV, linear TV to digital OTT and stuff like that. Even the consumption of linear TV behavior is undergoing a change. In this scenario now, how would you optimize between these two big channels? And that's where we are building these capabilities so that we can help marketers understand the consumer behavior on those two channels and then optimize accordingly.
Anushree, anything from your end, where do you think the changes will happen post-COVID?
So I think, from an entire marketing and communication standpoint, I think we always use probably the ART framework, as they say, authentic, relevant, talkable. The other piece that you will need to now add is probably empathy. Because as much as you can see what's happening today, I think more and more brands are actually creating value through more empathetic marketing interventions, whether it's in the form of communication, whether it's in the form of solutions. So I think that's going to be one of the filters that you will need to probably apply as you go forward when you are actually designing the communication, media, and technology mix, for marketing intervention. So I think empathy is going to be one of the keywords when you're actually designing interventions with your consumers, and hence make your brand more relevant and discoverable.
Interesting. Aditi, can you hear me?
Yes. Am I audible, Gautam?
Yeah, you are. So just wanted to sort of get your inputs on this question.
Yeah. No, I completely agree with what Siddharth and Anushree, talking about. I do think that, it's not bits and pieces, it's the entire customer journey that will have to be rethought. Whether it's an end user in case of B2C companies, it's the end user, the consumer. In case of B2B companies, it's again, the customers are sort of organizations or enterprises, but even they have undergone change, right? If you take a simple example, events marketing is something which, is a very traditional form of marketing, which exists always, right? But rethinking events marketing during COVID and post COVID, I think it's going to undergo a lot of change. It's not just the change of moving from, face-to-face events to moving to webinars. It's also about the entire process around it, understanding all the touch points. If in an event-based marketing, there was a particular way in which you were achieving, leads or demand generation or so on and so forth, how are you actually going to do that in an online world, right? So everything has to be rethought, according to me. Some of it will probably, over a period of time, in the medium term and long term, go back to normal. But there's still a need to rethink the user journey, rethink the customer journey in the post-COVID world overall. That's what my mind is.
Interesting. Vaibhav, if you can just help us answer this.
No, Gautam, I think it's very important for us as marketers to understand, that this switch from offline to online, right, hasn't happened because of a trend. It has happened because of an adversity. So it's not necessary that all consumers are as, easy. It's not very easy for consumers, for a lot of categories, to switch to online. Because that's contactless and digital it's a norm, right? Which they're not used to. So I think a significant amount of investment has to happen, especially for traditional businesses, on user experience, interface, assistance, tele-assistance, very critical. Very, very critical. It's not easy, right? For a large part of this country, still buying clothes means going to a shop, right? Going to Sarojini Nagar.
Yeah.
For a part of this country, buying life insurance means contacting Sharmaji from the neighborhood, right? So that is truth, right? And you can't change that truth overnight. So a lot of investment has to happen on empathetic communication, and more importantly, servicing. The chatbots have to play a very important role. People like to talk in India, whether we like it or not. They like to talk. We all like to talk. We like to be extremely assured of what we are buying at all points in time, right? Everyone, not all are millennials, we have to understand, right? There's a large part of this country who are not millennials. So serve them, you need to ensure that, your communication assistance engine is very strong. And I think besides that, I feel, you know, for a very long period, you know, for our markets, you know, relationship between the buyer and the seller has been equally important as the proposition, right? And now I think the proposition will take over, because a large number of transactions that happen in this country, right, happen when two people are sitting face to face with one person, when the seller looking at the buyer in the eye, right? And there's always an information arbitrage between the seller and the buyer. Now, yeah. Arbitrage will disappear, because if you're talking to me digitally, I always have my mobile phone, right, where I can start comparing. So the comparison will become a new norm for a lot of categories, which where it wasn't earlier, right? I mean, e-commerce was always comparison. Great. Travel was great comparison. Guess what? Loads of categories like where to open an FD was not a comparison point, right? You had a relationship.
Yeah.
With a bank. But guess what? The searches for the best FD rates has actually quadrupled in the last quarter. So suddenly people want to actually find out if they are getting the best FD rate or not, right?
True.
Proposition will become extremely important along with the relationship, I think.
It's very interesting that you raised the point on arbitrage. I think we were already seeing that with purchasing cars, you know, where we would sort of now go around shopping and you had a car valet that you would sort of go and see. Absolutely. Who's offering what deals. And I think I'm seeing that sort of trend happen more and more. And I think that's one thing that's going to happen for a lot of brands and organizations. So interesting. I think we are pretty much at the end of it. I'm going to open up the floor and sort of, you know, put out the questions that have come in. And I let each and every one of you sort of to, you know, answer anything that might sort of attract you. But I personally wanted to thank all of y'all. I think it's been a great learning experience for me. And it's always good to meet people, you know, wherein we can talk the same language. It's very difficult for digital people to talk to non-digital people in that sense. So any place that we can gather and have a conversation is a treat for me. Sadly, we are not one of those shows where I can hand out hampers. Otherwise, I would have done so. Hopefully we can again connect at some point or the other on something interesting that might come up. And I mean, personally, I'd like to thank E4M for making this happen for me. I'm just going to quickly sort of open up a few questions that have come in. So this one is from Mansi KG that's come in. It basically is that content and technology are the two big pillars of digital marketing. Both are looking at AI for better insights and everything. Some of the big newspapers in the globe have already created a certain percentage of their articles being created and collated by AI. You know, with both content and analytics moving towards automated technology, do you think this would be a challenge to marketers?
Maybe I can try to take this. So if I'm understanding correctly, Gautam, basically the question from Ansi is whether AI coming in is going to be a challenge for marketers.
Yeah, that's pretty much it.
Actually, again, of course, I am, you know, I have, I am founder of an AI company, so I would like to say no, but just to nuance it, I think, again, it is an enabler, right? To give an example, technologies such as edge AI, and on-device AI, the ability to actually gain insights from the device of the end user can give you data points that you as a marketer could never have access to, right? But typically as marketeers, we look at cohorts, we look at sort of segmentation in a more traditional way. But imagine if you have the ability to actually understand the insights of every individual user. So I do think it is, I mean, of course, it's going to change the way marketing happens, but I think it's going to change it for the better. I think it's only going to enable certain kind of, creativity. I think at one point, Siddharth or one of the panel members mentioned that, today you may not be able to personalize to the extent that you like to, but with AI coming in, you will be able to, because you have access to those insights and information. So I am a firm believer that it may modify the way marketing happens, but it is definitely not going to be a challenge or something that marketers need to worry about, as long as, you know, they are not left behind and they're ready to take on whatever the new age of sort of personalization using AI is. That's just my thought, Gautam.
Right. The second question is coming from Munish. He wants to know, how do marketers start thinking about building their MarTech stack? You know, with data silos and legacy systems being the reality, how does one actually go about building a stack?
So can I answer this? So I would say the best practice we have seen is that when you are looking at a particular problem, which is like a key problem for your business, right? And then around that, you start small. But you also take care that when you are creating So of course, meaning you have to basically look at data silos, legacy systems, and then you have to start creating a data system where you will try to start augmenting your data from various systems which you are having. But having said that, I think it is always good that you start with a problem solving, and that way you will be able to get an internal sponsorship, and then with that, but you also have your end goal in mind. You have that vision that this is how ultimately I will be able to integrate my data, but you take small steps, and as you start solving more and more problem for your organization, you will get more and more sponsorship and you will be able to realize that vision.
Right. In the interest of time, I'm just going to limit this to another two or three more questions. And this one actually has come in for you, Aditi. Sustainable development practices changing. Are they changing? Are they evolving the marketing any place? The example that has been given is promoting gender equality, saving water, reusing. Do you think that's something that is sort of getting more mileage now?
Can you help repeat the question again, Gautam? I'm not able
sorry.
To...
So I'm just going to sort of rephrase the question that has come in.
Sure.
Smita wants to know, saying that she wants to know that, are there any sustainable development practice that is changing marketing, that's helping marketing evolve? So, you know, when marketers go and sort of promote gender equality or saving water, reusing, recycling, do you think that's evolving? Do you think marketers are paying more attention to it?
I do think so. I think it is absolutely happening, and it is not just the prerogative of marketing. I think it is an organizational prerogative which is changing the way this is happening. So more and more organizations now, I talk about organizations at the largest level or even sort of smaller organizations, are focusing on sustainability, and the impact of that is it's becoming part of the key sort of goals of an organization, right? Again, I'll sort of maybe take the example of my time in Tata Group, which is one of those organizations which not only focuses on sustainability but also on a lot of path-breaking things that become norms later. I do think that marketing is closely related to it. So if there is an organizational effort, if there is an organizational strategy to do sustainability, then marketing essentially has to build around it. Even if you, for example, take examples of automotive companies, right? So there is, if you look at ads nowadays, there's always, there's mention about how, there's a sustainable angle to automotives as well, right? So I think it is changing, and marketing is playing a front role, but it is driven by strategy, the organizational strategy. I think that is essential, because it cannot be a siloed thing. It has to be an overall sort of organizational strategy to pick up key sustainability goals and also gender equality sort of goals.
Right. And this is the last question. I'm actually combining two questions on this one, and it's coming from a couple of people. They just want to know the top 2-3 tools that you guys are using to help understand your customers and to help understand data a bit better. So this is open to all three of y'all. If y'all just can just list a couple of tools that will help viewers that have tuned in to understand how do they go about sort of identifying and working with these tools.
So I think for party data, I personally believe nothing beats your own data analytics tool here, whether it's Omniture or a Google Analytics Premium. I mean, nothing beats that. I currently believe that's the richest source of information if used well. I mean, these are really very rich tools. If you go into the depth, there is so much information that you can acquire through them. I saw a question which said, how do you trust them when Google Analytics and the Google panels don't talk to each other, right? I said a question from Mansi. That's actually interesting. I understand.
Yeah.
That is Mansi. I completely do. We all face it. Trust me, the only source of truth is Google Analytics. That's the way I look at things, right? Well, when the prospect is on your platform, that is the only truth. Beyond that, there are pixels working from here and there. So you don't know what is right, what is wrong. Of course, the panels help you identify cost. But when it comes in terms of the consumer journey, I at least trust Google Analytics. I think the most powerful tool that I've experienced is the multi-stage attribution model. If you go through and you try and find out what is the entire user journey and what is the dominant user journey across sources of traffic, I think I find that extremely powerful, especially when I do a campaign. Me and my team spend a lot of time, at least 90 minutes, on mapping those consumer journeys to understand how different creative stimuli or a different proposition will lead to a different source, sources intermingling, and then look at the profile. So, you know, where did you come from? What did you do? And who you are? If I was to break this into three world parts, where did you come from?
Yeah.
What did you do? And who you are? I think Tino ka cross section best explained through Google Analytics. So I love that tool, honestly.
So that's
powerful.
So for my perspective, it is B2B. So we use Salesforce extensively, and then of course download that into Google Sheet or Excel and do the analysis and all those things.
Aditi, we're gonna end this entire thing with you. So you better have a really good tool now.
I already mentioned LinkedIn, so I don't know if I can get better than that. But I think for us, again, like as an enterprise, similar to Siddharth, we are also B2B focused and enterprise focused. So I think in our case, it always is case by case. We've typically stepped away from going after tools that are very big or that are focused on enterprises because we are a small company, right? So our requirements are very, very... So if it's, for example, if it's a CRM, instead of going for a CRM solution, which is really big, like an SAP, because we are still very small, we have used more agile tools. Actually, we are using agile CRM, so pun intended. But the point is, I think the way we have tackled it is looking at what exactly is a requirement and then picking the tool, but also trying to make sure as much as possible to make the tools talk to each other. Otherwise, what happens is as you scale, you end up building very siloed tools and siloed organizations as a result of which.
Right. So great. This has been very interesting for, I think, me personally and every student. I thank all of you. Please stay safe. And thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks everyone. Thanks, Gautam.
Quite a pleasure. Thank you so much.